Okay, if you could take your seats now, we're going to begin with the second talk for this morning. Our second speaker is Dr. Michael Ryan, and he'll be introduced by Dr. Romy Burks, Professor of Biology at Southwestern University. Dr. Burks.
Good morning. I'm still thinking about the chocolate question from the last talk, but thank you for the honor of allowing me to introduce Dr. Michael Ryan to our community. Michael J. Ryan is the Clark Hubbs Regents Professor in Zoology at the University of Texas at Austin. He received a BA in Life Sciences from Glassboro State College in New Jersey, followed that with a Master's of Science in Zoology from Rutgers, and then did his PhD also at Cornell in Neurobiology and Behavior. He was then a Miller Postdoctoral Fellow at the Museum of Vertebrate Zoology at the University of California, Berkeley, before he took a job back at the University of Austin, Texas, where he started as an assistant professor in 1982. He has remained there for the entirety of his career, although his field work has primarily taken him to Panama. So that's what you could read in your program. Here is my interpretation. He's ridiculously accomplished. His CV, which is the academic equivalent of a resume, is over 40 pages long. Dr. Ryan practiced integrative biology before it was really trendy. He's quoted as saying, if you want to understand living things, you really have to let all levels of analysis interact. I look at the success and impact of a scientist like this, and I wonder if he sleeps. Just a few highlights. He has published over 350 scientific papers, 13 of those in Science, 3 in Nature, and been involved in 5 books, including his most recent, A Taste for the Beautiful, The Evolution of Attraction. His 1985 book, The Toongara, hope I said that right, Frog, A Study in Sexual Selection and Communication, has been cited over 1,000 times. All right, this is my favorite. His H index, this is a measure of your scholarly impact from Google, is 93. Mine's a respectable 18. Dr. Pierce's is 21. Dr. Garacci's is 22. His is 93. Dr. Ryan is a fellow in both versions of AAAS, so that's the American Academy of Arts and Sciences and the American Association for the Advancement of Science, as well as the Guggenheim Institute. He's received several Distinguished Scientist Awards from Animal Behavior Society, the American Society of Naturalists, and the Museum of Vertebrate Zoology. Maybe some things you didn't know. He has a lovely website, outstanding and informational, and I'm sure that he just did that in his spare time. A Benedictine monk inspired his interest in evolutionary biology. He has 10 brothers and sisters. A New York Times article years ago suggested that he studies animals living between a rock and a hard place. Most of his first research grant, he says, was buying a good flashlight and batteries. There was an ice storm when he actually interviewed for his job at UT, so they did happen before. And his first time flying out of the country was to the tropics, and appropriately, the Galapagos. One last Paideia connection in my introductory comments, Dr. Ryan does identify Charles Darwin as his scientific hero. This piqued my own interest, as I will be teaching a class in Darwin in London in 2020, student deadline March 1st. All right, so no field trip to the Galapagos, unfortunately. Dr. Ryan's latest science publication is a co-authored semi-racy titled review, Sexual Selection and the Ascent of Women, Mate Choice Research Since Darwin. His talk today, A Taste for the Beautiful. Please welcome Dr. Michael Ryan to Southwestern.
Thank you, Romy, for that wonderful introduction. I'm just going to see if I can get a little higher here. Okay.
And I'd like to thank Ben and Faye for the invitation. It's a real honor. It's a real honor to test. Did someone say they can't hear me? Okay. It's a real honor to take part in this symposium, and I'm really excited by the diversity of speakers. And I'll be the only biologist here. And just to give you a heads up, when I'm not going to say non-human animals throughout this talk. So when I say animals, I mean non-human animals. And when I talk about humans, it'll be obvious because I'll show a picture of a human. So we know what we're talking about. Okay, a taste for the beautiful. So after Darwin proposed his natural selection theory in the book On the Origin of Species, he then started to wrestle with a much more significant problem than even natural selection. So remember, natural selection is the theory that explains how animals or organisms in general, how they evolve adaptations for survivorship. So Darwin started to survey a lot of the courtship traits that we see in the animal kingdom, and he became very concerned about this. So what I want to do is just show some of the kinds of animals and traits that caused this consternation on Darwin's behalf. So we'll start with the peacock, because the peacock is kind of the mascot of sexual selection. And as we see here, the male is erecting his feathers and then he'll shake his feathers as he's courting a female. Now, we know that the females find these tails very enchanting, but it's this beautiful structure that Darwin declared it made him sick every time he saw it. And we're going to return back to this little health problem of Darwin's in a bit. This is the red bird of paradise. This is a inhabitant of Indonesia. And this is a male. The males are distinguished by these tail wires. These are feathers that come out the side. And interestingly, when the male's courting the female, it seems that the male is being encircled by a heart as he's trying to convince the females to mate. Now, this bird is the national bird of Guatemala. It's on their flag coat of arms, and it's the resplendent quetzal. And a lot of birders consider this the most beautiful bird in the world. And I still have vivid memories of my binoculars shaking in my hands the first time I saw one of these. This is an animal that we don't know that much about. It's the golden-headed lion tamarin. It's an endangered species that lives in the lowlands of Bahia, Brazil. Bahia's on the coast of Brazil. And these are monogamous, and the parents not only raise the offspring together, they actually raise the juveniles together. But we know almost nothing else about this animal. And amongst many primatologists, people will refer to this tamarin as the world's most beautiful primate. And I don't know if that's considering humans or not, probably so. Now, this is an amazing little animal. This is called a peacock spider. It's a type of jumping spider, and it's referred to as the peacock spider because its abdomen kind of resembles a peacock's tail. And like the peacock's tail, the male only displays this abdomen when he's courting females. So he erects the abdomen in much the way that the peacock erects its tail feathers, and then he shakes his abdomen back and forth as an invitation to the females to mate. Now, this is a picture of male and female fireflies signaling to one another. This is a time-lapse photograph of synchronous fireflies that are in the Smoky Mountains in Tennessee. And this communication between the sexes is necessary for mating to take place. And like many of these courtship traits that Darwin surveyed, these are species specific. That means that the flashing patterns of one species is different than the flashing patterns of other species. And as I'll mention later, this allows the individuals making the choices in the sexual marketplace to choose individuals of the same species. This is a picture of a variety of guppies. These are found in mostly in streams in Trinidad. And the guppies are well known for their spectacular colors, but they're also well known for the variation in these colors. And they especially vary between different streams in Trinidad, but they also vary in populations in the same stream. And we're going to talk about how this variation might be very adaptive. Now, often in sexual selection, it's thought that that mate choice results in males and females looking a bit different. So these are, this is a collared lizard from the southwestern United States. You can see them very commonly in Big Bend, for example. And this is the male on the top, and this is the female on the bottom. So in Darwin's 1871 book on the descent of man and selection in relation to sex, Darwin surveyed hundreds of different kinds of these traits. And what did Darwin surmise from this? Well, in a lot of cases, these traits were sexually dimorphic. That is, they differ between the sexes. Usually they're more extreme in males. They can be involved in sexual attraction or sexual combat. So they can be armaments or they can be ornaments. And the thing that really concerned Darwin was that these traits just seemed to be maladaptive for survival. There's no way that a male peacock dragging this train that's over feathers that's over a meter long, that this is going to help them escape from predators. So putting all of these observations together, Darwin proposes the theory of sexual selection. And sexual selection is defined as the proportion, the variation in reproductive success that can be assigned to variation in mating success. Now, sexual selection doesn't apply to all sexual behavior in nature. It's specifically explaining that sometimes individuals that mate more often have more reproductive success. Then he made this very controversial conclusion, and that is that many of these traits are favored by female mate choice. So in a lot of mating systems, there's individuals that court and there's individuals that choose. In many of them, the males are the courters and the females are the choosers. So Darwin proposed that a lot of these traits evolve, and again, they seem to be maladaptive for survival, but a lot of these traits evolve because they're more attractive to choosers, and in that case, females. So one question that Darwin was not able to readily answer is why is there this direction of difference between males and females? Why is it the males that are usually the courters and the females that are usually the choosers? Now, I do want to point out that Darwin lost a lot of his allies when he made this suggestion about female mate choice. Remember, this is being suggested in Victorian England in the mid to late 1800s. And some of his most ardent backers, such as Thomas Huxley and Alfred Wallace, just really abandoned Darwin and wrote extensively how Darwin was wrong. There is no evidence at all that female animals would have the power to make this mating decision. And a lot of historians of science have suggested that a lot of this reaction was just because of the cultural norms at the time. Victorian wars could not allow females to have this much power, even if we're talking about non-human animals. So why is this the case? Why do we tend, and I'm going to show a lot of exceptions to this, but why is there the tendency for males to be the courters and females to be the choosers? And to understand that, we have to dig down past the external phenotype, these fancy traits that the males often have, that the courters have, to look at their gametes. So this is a picture of a human egg and a human sperm. It only takes one egg and one sperm to produce an offspring, in most cases, and there's always a lot of variation. In most species, the egg is the largest cell in that species, and the sperm is the smallest cell in that species. In humans, for example, during her lifetime, a female will have 100 or so eggs, and a male will have 1 billion or so sperm. So what that means is that there's a lot of sperms out there competing to get access to an egg. Now, since the sperm are in the males and the eggs are in the females, what this means is that the females are the limiting sex. And so you have males competing with each other, whether it's sexual combat or whether it's sexual, they're trying to attract the female. You have many males competing for fewer females. Now, in most species, almost all the females get to mate. In most species of animals, all the females get to mate. And in many species, and maybe it's even most species, most males die as virgins. They never have any opportunity to mate. So there's very strong selection on males to try to maximize their ability to mate. Whereas with females, the suggestion is the selection on females is to assay the males and be sure that they're mating with males who are at least of the right species. Now there's a lot of variation that we know of now that Darwin didn't know about. So we always think of male. If you want to tell the difference between males and females, you pull down their genes. Males have an intermittent organ, a penis, and females have a vagina. So if you look carefully here, you'll see that there's two insects. These are lice, and they have this really interesting natural history. They live in caves in southern Brazil, and they eat bat guano. That's all they feed on is bat feces. Now, in a lot of animals that have internal fertilization, the male is on top and the female is the bottom, and then the male inseminates the female. But this is a little bit different. In this case, it's the female that's on top and the male that's on the bottom. Well, big deal. Well, it ends up that it is a big deal because, as the authors refer to it, the females have a penis and the males have a vagina. So I prefer to refer to the female's organ as an intermittent organ rather than a penis, because that can confuse some things. But the way their mating works is that the females climb on top of the males, and then they take this intermittent organ that's kind of like a straw, and they insert it into the male's quote-unquote vagina, into his cloacal opening, and she sucks up the sperm from the male, and then the sperm comes in this intermittent organ and then eventually worked its way to the female's eggs, and that's how fertilization takes place. You know, Darwin didn't have a clue that there was this kind of variation in the natural world. There's something else that Darwin didn't know about, or at least didn't get right, and that was the role of women in making societal decisions about mate choice. So there's this wonderful book by this historian of science, Evelyn Richards, Darwin and the Making of Sexual Selection. And she has this great quote in this book. She says, Darwin naturalized female choice among animals and normalized male choice among humans. So Darwin was willing to buck these Victorian mores when it came to suggesting that female mate choice was important in animals. But then as soon as he started talking about humans, he flipped and males were in total control of the mating decisions. And Darwin also pointed out that one of the reasons might be is because females are intellectually inferior to males. I mean, he was certainly a misogynist, not that he hated women, but he certainly had these social biases against women. We also know, as Ben pointed out earlier this morning, that even though female choice of males is more common than male choice of females, that there is a whole lot of variation. So for instance, the skeletons in humans, we know that there's mutual mate choice is very important. And my guess is we'll probably hear something of this when David Buss gives his talk this afternoon. There are also animals in which there's male choice of females. So on the top here, the bird is a jacana. Underneath the jacana is a pipefish. To the right of the pipefish is a seahorse. Now, pipefishes and seahorses, they're in the same family, Cygnathidae. And in these fishes, males, quote unquote, become pregnant. So the embryo, after it's fertilized, it's implanted into the male's pouch. And then the male takes care of the developing embryo until it's then released to the environment. So what happens here is that males become the limiting sex, and then females are competing with other females for access to males. Now, there was a recent review of what we call the strength of sexual selection across many, many species in the animal kingdom. So what this graph does, it measures how strong sexual selection is on males, how strong is sexual selection on females. And what this graph shows is if you're to the left of the horizontal line, sexual selection is stronger on females. If you're to the right of this horizontal line, sexual selection is stronger in males. So what we see by looking at this graph, there's a huge amount of variation. There's not a typical mating system for animals. It varies all over the place. And that there are a lot of species, and this red arrow is pointing to the seahorse, where sexual selection is actually stronger on males than on females. So again, there's a whole lot of variation that we know about now that wasn't accessible to Darwin when he proposed his theory of sexual selection. But on the other hand, this graph does show, and I'm not talking about humans, I'm talking about non-human animals, does show that Darwin was basically correct, that most of the time, sexual selection is stronger on males than on females. And most of the time, it's females that get to make the mating decision rather than males. Okay, so what about this antipathy that Darwin had towards the peacock's tail? And that's very odd, you know, because the peacock's tail is, I mean, it enchants females, but it also enchants us. It's a beautiful structure. And Darwin wrote a letter to this famous North American botanist, Asa Gray, where he stated, the sight of a feather in a peacock's tail, whenever I gaze at it, makes me sick. Now, we do know that Darwin was a legitimate hypochondriac, but this malady was probably due to cognitive dissonance. He just wrote this very well-received book on natural selection, On the Origin of Species, where he argued that selection favors traits that promote survivorship. And now he's thinking about sexual selection, where he's surveying many, many traits that clearly don't promote survivorship. So how do you reconcile this? So what I want to do now is show you just a little bit, give you a little flavor of the kinds of studies that we've done that other people have done looking at sexual selection in animals. So this frog here, it's called the Tungara frog. And above the Tungara frog is a photo of Barro, Colorado Island. This is an island in the middle of the Panama Canal. And it's a wildlife refuge that's part of the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute. And that's where I started my graduate studies. And I'm actually still studying sexual selection and communication in this frog. Mostly because we just are getting more and more tools that allow us to ask different kinds of questions about these frogs. And there's lots and lots of detail that that I can't go over here. But these frogs, they're like a lot of frogs in that they breed from pools of water. And the males gather into a chorus. There's lots of frogs that do this around here. And the males have a mating call. So there's about 6,000-7,000 species of frogs. Almost all of them have mating calls. And all of those mating calls are specific to that species. So females can tell the difference, as we can just by listening, can tell the difference between species A and species B just by listening to the calls. Now, I'm not going to talk about it, but we've done a lot of work on the neural systems underlying this recognition. We've done a lot of, we meaning my colleagues, have done a lot of electrophysiology studies on the inner ear and a lot of gene expression studies and central nervous system. So we have a pretty good idea, not a perfect idea, but we pretty well know what the brain is telling the female frog. And we have this understanding, not only how she goes to the call of her own species, but why she prefers certain variants, which I'll talk about now. So I'm going to show you a very short video of one of these males calling in a chorus. Now, there's no way you can easily parse out that male's call from the sonorous background. But they have a very interesting call. On the bottom left here, this is a picture of the calls. These are waveforms on the top. It shows how energy changes with time. And this is a sonogram on the bottom, which shows how frequency changes with time. So by looking at the waveform, we know it gets loud and then it gets soft. By looking at the sonogram, we know it sweeps down in frequency. So these males have a complex call for a frog. They always produce a whine. That's the species signature. But if they want to, they can add a chuck to its call. So the whine sounds like this, and a whine with a chuck sounds like this. Or better yet, we can hear a male making these exact four calls. And they can make up to seven of these chucks. Now, if a male's calling by himself in the field, he only makes a whine. But if you answer the male's calling, if you say, then he'll respond, and if you say back to him, he will say, you can't really get them to make all seven of their chucks, but you can all easily get them to escalate. So the obvious question that we had here is, why do they make chucks at all? Well, they're at a breeding site. They're advertising to females. So that suggests, well, maybe they're trying to attract females. So an advantage of working with these kinds of animals is you can ask them these questions and they tell you the answers. So for instance, why do you make a whine chuck? Is this more attractive to females than a whine? So we collect these females in the field. Again, we're in Panama. We bring them, I have a lab in Panama. We bring them into a walk-in acoustic chamber. Then from one speaker, we play a whine, and the other speaker, we play a whine and a chuck. So the female is hearing, and they will hop right up to the speaker, thinking that this is a calling male, and this is the male they would like to mate with. if you scale it to body size, the females have to move about 8 relative to our size. They have to move about 80 meters to get to the speaker. So we've done this experiment many times, about 5,000 times over the last 20 years or so. And what we find every year, and it's fairly consistent, is that females prefer calls with chucks to calls without chucks. It's a fivefold preference. So think about us. What could we possibly do to ourselves to make ourselves 5 times more attractive? And for relatively free, we measured how much energy it costs to make these calls. It costs a lot of energy, a lot of metabolic energy to make a wine, nothing to add a chuck to the call. And we understand why that's so. There's a good biophysical reason for that. So if making chucks makes the male so much more attractive, and he's in the breeding pond in order to attract females, then why not always make chucks? And here's the answer.
There's a predator that hunts Tungara frogs by homing in on their calls. The more distinctive the call, the easier the target. Silence is the safest strategy.
So this bat is trichopsorosis. We call it the frog-eating bat for obvious reasons. And when I was a graduate student, Merlin Tuttle, who's a well-known bat conservation biologist in Austin, Merlin wasn't in Austin at the time, we didn't discover the species, but we discovered that these bats were going to frog calls. And they responded to variation in the frog calls very much like females do. If you were to play to a bat, only that whine component, you know, the bat will fly in the flight cage and land on the speaker, sometimes trying to rip into the speaker looking for the frog. And we can also put speakers out in the jungle and then just sit on the side with a night vision scope and we can see the bats come out of the canopy. But like the female frogs, the bats prefer calls with chucks to calls without chucks. And like the female frogs, it's almost a fivefold preference. So the advantage of making chucks is pretty well balanced by the disadvantage of attracting bats. And bats aren't the only ones that are in on this eavesdropping game. So what we've also found, and one of my former students who's at Purdue now, Imena Bernal, these little flies, they're midges, and they land on the frogs. At one time we thought they were just mosquitoes. They land on the male and they walk around on his back while he's calling. Then they walk inside his nares and then they take a blood meal from the capillaries that are near the surface. And these flies act just like the female frogs and the frog-eating bats. If you go in the field and you play wines and you have a little trap so you can collect the flies, the midges that come to the speaker, they will go, just the wine only attracts the females. But when you give these midges a choice between a wine chuck and a wine, the midges also prefer the complex call. So this is what Darwin envisioned, that you can have these maladaptive traits maladaptive for survival, but they can still evolve if the disadvantage of survivorship is balanced by the advantage of increasing your mate choice. But we're talking about mate choice. I mean, a big question is, why should you choose at all? And there are some non-controversial answers to that question. Like I said, many of these courtship signals are species specific. We know that if two different species mate with one another, that they usually are not fertile offspring. That's not always the case. Think of human and Neanderthals. We can have 6, 7, 8% or more Neanderthal genes in our genome. So there was some successful between species reproduction that took place there. But you see here on the bottom left, a frog amplexing a salamander, and you don't have to be much of a biologist to know that that's not going to go anywhere. So there's strong selection on the choosers to choose the correct species. Also, there's certain characteristics in the courting animals that might be beneficial to the choosers. So if the in species where the courters contribute to the offspring, then the choosers, usually females, if they can assess which males are going to be parents, then selection favors those choosers to choose the individual who's going to be the better parent. But Darwin had a very different suggestion to explain a lot of these mate choice patterns. Darwin suggested that choosers might be attracted to beauty just for the sake of beauty. Or as he phrased it, that it might be that choosers have, quote unquote, a taste for the beautiful. This is a quote, not from his sexual selection book, but on the next book that he wrote on emotion in man and animals. And Darwin says, when male animals utter sounds in order to please females, they would naturally employ those sounds which are sweet to the ears of the species. So what Darwin's saying here is that the females, the choosers, have a particular construct, neural cognitive construct of what's attracted to them. And the males are going to be under selection evolutionarily to probe the female's nervous system and her cognitive system to find out what it is that she finds attractive. So we expanded on this idea that courters evolve traits that exploit pre-existing sensory biases, and we refer to this as sensory exploitation. Now I'm going to give you two quite simple examples of how this works. So this is the tungra frog on the top, and beneath it is one of its relatives, the Colorado frog. Now in this genus, there's about 50 species of frogs. The tungra frog and its closest relative, its sister species that's found in the Amazon, they can add chucks. Nobody else can add chucks. So this Colorodorum frog that's found in Ecuador on the western side of the Andes produces a whine-like call, like every frog in this genus, but the whines tend to be different. So this is what the whine of the Colorado frog call sounds like. Very short. Now, like I said, they don't make chucks, but we can ask these females, how would you respond to a call with chucks if one of your males was to suddenly evolve chucks? So we take three chucks from a tungra frog call and we put it on the call of this Colorado frog. And what we see is that there's a strong preference for the chucks, even though they've never heard chucks before. As Lisa referred to with the chocoholics, they have this desire for chocolate, but in our lingo, we would call this a hidden preference if there's no chocolate around to elicit that preference. And then chocolate pops up, and then you have individuals ready to feast on it. And this is it's similar to what we're talking about here. Another example, these are swordtails on the top and platyfish underneath. And swordtails have swords and platyfish don't. Now, if we look to the right, this is a family tree of these frogs, of these fishes. There's about 15 or so species of swordtails, about the same number of species of platyfish. Swords are in swordtails. They're not in any other closely related fishes. Platyfish lack swords, as do guppies and mollies. Well, how would a platyfish respond to a male if they were to evolve a sword? So Alex Pasolo quite a while ago, did this wonderful experiment. She took plattyfish and she attached to the plattyfish a plastic sword. And she gave the female plattyfish a choice between two plattyfish, one with a sword and one without a sword. And lo and behold, the females had a preference for the male, the plattyfish males that had the sword, even though they had never experienced a sword tail. They had never seen a sword in nature. So here we can ask then, well, when did the swords evolve and when did the preference for the sword evolve? And the sword evolved at the base of the sword tail group, but the preference for the sword must have evolved before the plattyfish, because the plattyfish and the swordtails share the same preference, even though the trait is only exhibited by the swordtail. So this is another example of sensory exploitation. And one of my colleagues, Molly Cummings, and I wrote a review a few years ago, 4 or 5 years ago, and we report about 200 studies that support this idea, sensory exploitation. That's not to say in all cases when choosers have preferences for certain traits, we're not arguing that in all cases this might be sensory exploitation, but it certainly seems to be true in a whole variety of species. Now, what are some other ways that courters can make themselves more attractive to choosers? Well, one thing that we know in humans, and this is also true in animals, that animals can get bored of having the same stimuli again and again and again. So in a lot of cases, it was suggested that just being different can make an individual more attractive, even if it's being somewhat ridiculous in this process of trying to be different. So this is a study of habituation in zebra finches, and habituation is just this process of getting bored. So what they show here is that if you measure the rate of action potentials in auditory neurons in their brain, and you measure their behavior, how much time they spend looking at a speaker, when you replace a familiar song with a novel song, you get increased responses both in the brain's auditory centers, as well as in the behavior. So birds can have very complex song repertoires. And one hypothesis for the evolution of song repertoires is that the females are more attracted to repertoires that are more variable because it keeps them from being habituated. And then you can take these experiments a little further and look at some traits that appear absolutely ridiculous. A number of years ago, Nancy Burley just put little hats on these zebra finches. And what she showed is that these animals with hats were more attractive than the normal to the females than the normal males without hats. So again, there seems to be some advantage in these systems to being different. And it's the same thing with guppies. I mentioned that guppies are well known for their vibrant colors, but also for the variation in their colors. So this is a recent study where they raised guppies in the lab. So line A is one line of guppies and line B is another line of guppies. In both of these, the males are characterized by these very bright, vibrant colors, but they're different from one another. The patterns are different. So what they show is that the female sexual receptivity tends to wane when she's repeatedly presented with males from her own line. But now when you present her with males from the other line, her sexual receptivity increases. And this goes in both directions. So again, another suggestion that habituation might regulate preferences of choosers for traits and courters. And one of the defining characteristic of these sexually selected courtship traits is that they're incredibly variable, very variable. So let's shift gears a little bit and talk about emotions. Now, we know that an animal's phenotype can predict its emotions. So this is from a very old book by Conrad Lorenz, one of the founders of ethology, Man Meets Dog. And what he does here, he draws the various facial patterns of dogs, and he suggests that at the end point in the top left, that is a dog that's the most fearful, and then on the bottom right, that's a dog that's the most aggressive. And we're all probably familiar with the differences in the dogs, right? When they're fearful, they put down their ears, they tend to slump their head down, whereas an aggressive male, the ears stay up, the lips move, so you can see the canines. Now, not only is this the relationship between visual cues or visual signals and emotion, it's also true with acoustic signals. So in many mammals, when an animal is fearful, and we'll stick with the dog example, it tends to make high-pitched, pure-tone sounds. When they're most aggressive, they tend to make very noisy, low-pitched growls. Very different sounds coming out of the same larynx. So we know that there's this correlation between emotion and acoustic cues. But what I'd like to ask now, can acoustic cues elicit, release certain emotional states? Now, just this morning, there was a clip on NPR about a colony of Barbary macaques in the UK. And these guys have, these animals haven't been reproducing for a while. So the keepers are trying to find a way to get them to reproduce. So they decided, well, they should be hearing a little bit of Marvin Gaye. That'll put them in the mood. But they weren't playing Marvin Gaye songs to the macaques. They hired musicians to come in and play and sing Marvin Gaye songs to the macaques. And they don't know how successful it's been. They're not going to know, and I think it's in the fall when they actually start to give birth. But you know, we do know in humans that we do know that music might soothe the savage beast, but we also know that it can really jack around our emotions. So in the 1700s, Christian Schubart suggested the different kinds of emotions elicited by different keys in the musical scale. So, for example, in D major, he said this is the key of triumph, of hallelujahs, of war cries, of victory rejoicing, blah, blah, blah. We also know that minor keys are always thought to elicit sadder emotions. So D minor, he refers to this as melancholy womanliness, the spleen and the humor's brood, and F sharp minor, a gloomy key, it tugs at passion as a dog biting a dress. Resentment and discontent are its language. But in terms of things that we're interested in, A major, this includes declarations of innocent love, satisfaction with one's state of affairs, hope of seeing one's beloved again when parting, youthful cheerness and trust in God, and B flat major, cheerful love, clear conscience, hope, aspirations for a better world. So that was in the 1700s. More recently, there is a study asking to what degree can music modulate sexual patterns in males, in humans, in men. So it's a pretty easy experiment to do, right? Take a guy, you play him some music, you have him watch some porn video, you measure his erection and ask him how horny he is. And then you compare these data between males that hear what is predicted to be songs that should be sexually arousal versus sound music that should not be. So this this piece from Mozart, it was hypothesized that this should elicit sexual arousal, and this is what the males were played. And then for the downer music, which should keep the males from being sexually aroused, it's from Barber. Now in this study, you know, they explain in great detail the two musical clips that were used in the treatments. But then the males would be watching the same porn video, and then the researchers don't say anything about the porn video. But it doesn't matter whether they're doing the physiological measures that correlate with sexual arousal, or they're doing, the males are doing self-reporting, what they find is there's a very big difference between the two treatment groups and those that heard Mozart versus the downer music. So this is an example then of how humans can use these external cues, not necessarily to increase their attractiveness, although there's certainly plenty of that, but in order to manipulate the emotional state of potential sexual partners. Now, mate choice does not take place in isolation. It usually takes place, back to animals now, it usually takes place in a social setting where there's other individuals that can witness the sexual act. And quite often, what an individual witnesses can actually influence their own preferences. So these are very bizarre fish. On the top left, the male, the individual on the top is a male, and that's a self and Molly. Self and Mollies are like most fish. There's males and there's females, and the males and the females mate, blah, 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 blah. They have offspring. The fish on the bottom is a female. It's another species. It's an Amazon Molly. Amazon Mollies don't have any females. I'm sorry, Amazon Mollies don't have any males. They reproduce by a system that's called gynogenesis on the right here. What happens during gynogenesis is the sperm contacts the egg and it stimulates the fertilization membrane and embryogenesis begins. But the sperm is not incorporated into the female's gamete. So the males that mate with the female, they're not getting any genetic benefit out of doing this. So we asked a number of years ago, why would a male sailfin mate with a female Amazon if there's no Darwinian fitness advantage to that? So the studies of mate choice in animals were just beginning in those days. So we asked whether there might be mate choice copying. So the basic idea is when a male sailfin is mating with a female Amazon, if one of his own females, a female sailfin, if she's watching this guy, does he now become more attractive? So he did this really simple experiment. On the top here, what we do is we put a female in the middle of an aquarium, and then there's a male on each side that's blocked off from the female by a plexiglass wall. And these are all sailfin mollies, and we ask, which male do you prefer? And she will prefer the larger male to the smaller male. Then what we do, we put the female, we restrict her to the center of the tank in this glass cylinder. Now the unpreferred male is given a female Amazon Molly, and the focal female, the female sailfin, she can see this. She can see this male consorting with another female. On the right-hand side, this male is also given, the preferred male is also given a Amazon Molly, but the focal female can't see it. She's blocked from seeing that. So we do that, then we remove these model females and we repeat the experiment. And what we see now is that the females change their preference. They now prefer what was the unpreferred male rather than, they now show a greater attraction to the unpreferred male. Okay, now males can tell the difference between an Amazon Molly and a sailfin Molly. And they prefer to mate with their own species. So the males have a percept of utility or quality, and they're more attractive. They find sailfin females more attractive than Amazon females. So what we did is we asked, does it matter how good looking this female model is? So now what we do is the female on the top, the females prefer the larger male on the right. We put the focal female in the middle again. Now we give both of the, we give the preferred male an Amazon female and the unpreferred male a sailfin female. And then we take out those model females and we repeat the experiment. And again, we see that there's a significant shift in preference towards the unpreferred male with, from the eyes of the male, with the higher quality female. These kinds of studies have been now repeated in humans, where they're not actually mate choice studies, but asking people to rate the attractiveness of faces. And I'm going to talk about one of these recent studies with humans that asks a different question, because when this study was conducted, in terms of rating the attractiveness of faces, we know that something analogous to mate choice copying is happening. But, which I like to remind myself and others, is that sure, the brain is an important sex organ, but it also has other things on its mind. And I think that's demonstrated very nicely by this study of humans. So what they do is they have subjects sitting at a computer and they're asked to rate the attractiveness of a particular face. And if I remember correctly, there's males rating the attractiveness of male and female faces and females rating the attractiveness of both. Then once all the subjects make their decision, this average information is reported back to the individuals. So for example, in the center, this male face was rated of intermediate attractiveness. Then the subject is saying, well, that's, you rated it intermediate, but the average of us think it's more attractive than that. Would you like to rate it again? And the subject does. And what you see is that there's always, almost always a shift of their preference towards the average preference for the social group, the average attractiveness rating. And the shift's not trivial. It's a 13% shift in their rating of attractiveness. But what these folks did, which was so interesting, they repeated the experiment with the same subjects. But they asked them to rate the attractiveness of hands. And they asked them to rate the attractiveness of art. And what they showed is that there was still about a 13% shift in response to quote unquote peer pressure, in response to mate choice copying. So what these authors suggest, and I happen to think that they're right, is that this mate choice copying, quote unquote mate choice copying in humans, it's probably not domain specific. It's not being exhibited in humans because somehow, whether genetically or culturally, it's taking place because it's an advantage to the individual doing the choice. They suggest that we know that social facilitation is very common in humans. We know that we copy lots and lots of things. So they make the argument that this quote unquote mate choice copying that they uncovered might just be an epiphenomenon of social facilitation in general.
Okay, and I'm going to finish up now. I think I'm doing okay on time, right? Yeah. I'm going to finish up now with just a few simple studies to show how deceptive and actually nefarious sexual quarters can be. And it reminded me of this line from by Jim Morrison that sex is full of lies. So these are some really interesting examples. So these fishes here, they're called tetracarassins, and they're found in Trinidad. Now, if you look at the animal on the right, that's the male. And if you look carefully, you'll see coming out from his body is what looks like a shish kebab with a piece of meat on the end. Well, that's a pectoral ray from his fin, and that piece of meat at the end of the ray is actually a piece of the male. So that's his flesh. So what he does is when there's a female in the vicinity, he picks up one of his pectoral fins, and both of the pectoral fins are like that. He picks up one of the pectoral fins and he waves this little piece of meat. And then the female comes over and she'll bite at it. And at that point, the male lowers the pectoral fin back into his body and starts courting the female. So he's deceiving the female with a piece of food in order to get her close enough that he can court with her. Now, this example is interesting. Bats eat a lot of moths. Moths have evolved ears on the side of their body that allow them to hear the ultrasonic calls of bats. The moths have also evolved the ability to make calls that are up in this ultrasonic range where bats make their echolocation calls. And supposedly this allows the moths maybe to jam the echolocation of the bats, or maybe to advertise to the bats that they're distasteful. It's the jury's a little bit out on that. Now what happens, if we look at this graph here, the bats will start flying around looking for insects. Now if we could hear these echolocation calls, we'd hear something like, and you can go to places around here, a famous place, the Congress Street Bridge in Austin, and you can get these little bat detectors that now we can get them on an iPhone. They're quite cheap, and you can hear these ultrasonic calls. As the bat gets closer to a swarm of insects, it increases the rate of these echolocation calls. Now when it starts to home in on a moth, it makes, as we see on the right-hand side here, what's referred to as a feeding buzz. And it does this because it's approaching the moth very quickly and it needs its information to be updated very fast. So it makes these feeding buzzes. This moth, the Asian corn borer, what happens here is the males produce sounds like a lot of these moths do. The male will approach a female and he mimics the feeding buzz of a bat. Now the female's not flying, she's stationary. If she were flying, when a moth's flying and it hears a bat call, it just quickly drops out of the sky. But if it's not flying, then it freezes, doesn't move. So this is the nefarious part. So the males imitate the bat's feeding buzz. The female freezes, and the male climbs on top of her and mates with her, and she gives no resistance. And I know not these authors, I know another researcher who found this in another species of moth, and he said that if you play them a feeding buzz, you can go up to the moth and you can push them. You can knock them around and they won't move. The males will also freeze too, unless they're the ones imitating the bat. Now, the very last thing that I wanted to mention is what's extremely deceptive, really full of lies, are orchids. These are called deceptive orchids. Now, we know that for a lot of flowering plants, they need to be pollinated. So the way it works is that the flowers produce nectar. The pollinators come to the flower to feed on the nectar. While they're feeding on the nectar, they get pollen on their body. Then when they go to the next flower, they inadvertently fertilize that flower with the pollen. Now, deceptive orchids don't produce any pollen, any nectar at all, but it's pollinated. So how does it do that? Well, it looks crude, but the shape of the flowers here seem to resemble the silhouette of a female orchid bee. These are called orchid bees. Not only that, the orchids produce an odor that not only mimics the female's pheromone, the female's odors. If you give a bee a choice between two dummy bees, one you cover with orchid odor and one you cover with the odor of virgin females, they actually prefer the odor of an orchid to their own virgin female. So this is another way that that animals can be deceived into mating. Although we find orchids beautiful to look at, the bees are deceived by them. So what I wanted to do today was just give you a little bit of an overview about these sexual selection studies in animals, and suggest that this suggestion by Darwin, this taste for the beautiful, really does seem to exist. And it often evolves for other reasons than mate choice alone. And a lot of the research that I talked about, of my own research, a lot of it was done in Panama, where I'm a research associate with the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute. And we've gotten funding both from my university and National Science Foundation. And we've had the assistance of close to 100 interns over the many years of this study. So if there's any questions.
So you can come up here to the front and use the mic. You can stand up and just shout out your question. Or if you want to write your question on a piece of paper, we're glad to, the students who come around and grab those and bring those up to me for me to read. Also, we're going to try and monitor questions on the chat. So if you're on the live stream and you'd like to ask a question, just put it into the Q&A session on the live stream, and we'll try to get those questions. So let me get a microphone for you.
Got it.
Oh, got it? Okay. So do we have any questions people would like to ask?
I would do one online.
Okay, Faye.
What are the implications for urbanization on sexual selection? And has it had an effect on mating behavior over the years?
Yes, it does in a lot of ways. For instance, in these frogs that we study, they will call in urban environments and in rural environments. And the predation risk is different between those two environments. The number of complex calls that they'll produce is different between those environments. I think the most interesting studies aren't those studies that we've done, but studies in Europe where they look at bird song in urban and rural areas. And what they find is that bird song, the frequencies are higher in the urban areas. And they show this keeps the songs above the industrial background noise. And just one more example, because it's really relative to COVID. When the pandemic started, as you all probably remember, there's very little automobile traffic. So there were a lot of historical recordings of white-crowned sparrows in California, including the area right around the Golden Gate Bridge. And what they showed is that during the pandemic, the pitch, the frequency of the birds' calls near the Golden Gate Bridge all came down in frequency and now matched the calls of sparrows in rural areas. So there is light pollution is probably also playing a big role. And certainly we know for sure that pesticides are, you know, they can cause abnormalities in the larynx of frogs in response to different kinds of pesticides. So yes, there's a lot of effects of urbanization on the sexual displays of these frogs, of these animals, I should say.
So other questions? People have some other questions they want to ask? So I'll ask a question. You talked about the novelty and how that there's an attraction to novelty, and I can understand how that can overcome habituation, but isn't there a danger in if there's too much attraction to novelty that you might wind up mating with the wrong species?
Yeah, so this is clearly bounded by these species recognition signals. So just as an example, with the whine and the chuck of the tundra frog call, we can remove that chuck and replace it with lots of different sounds. We can replace it with white noise. And we literally replaced it in one experiment with a bell and a whistle. And the females prefer a whine with a bell and a whistle to a whine by itself. But if you manipulate the whine, there you don't have many degrees of freedom to manipulate it before the females start to ignore it.
So we have any other questions? Yes. You want to come up here?
So building off of that novelty question, so have you done studies or someone else that you're aware of done studies where you have some manipulation and then you continuously expose the mate to that manipulation? They're like the little caps or something. Do they eventually decrease in the novelty preference and that kind of goes away, or does that maybe after they're allowed to mate with them, do they stop preferring that? They go back to their original unaltered?
That's a really good question. And one thing that is worth pointing out is that, to thinking about heritability from Lisa's talk, in these frogs, there's no learning involved in their calls or their preference for calls. So we raise them from when they were tadpoles to when they're sexually mature, where they're hearing either the call of their own males or a different species or traffic noise, and all the males end up making the same species typical call, and all the females end up showing the same preferences. But with birds and with fishes, people have done experiments where the type of courting males during development certainly does have an influence on the mate choice. So we did a study with one of these swordtail species where we keep females with males of another species for a few weeks, and then we do a mate choice experiment, and now there's a stronger tendency to go to the wrong species, probably because they've been exposed to that odor for so long. We have a very good understanding of the development of song learning in birds, but we don't really have much of an understanding of the role of development, especially the environment during development, in other animals. We know in these frogs that it doesn't make any difference, but for other animals we're just not sure. So if you know, a lot of these other animals, like birds have culture. I mean, bird song learning is passed on amongst individuals. Mistakes are passed on amongst individuals. They have to learn. They have to hear the song to learn it. There's a genetic component, but there's a very, very strong learning component, which then gives rise to cultural variation among populations.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for your question. Do we have any other questions?
We have a question online. What overlap have you seen in human sexual communication and resistance to sex with non-human research? So overlap between, or similarities between humans and some of these, like these animals.
Well, I mean, you're probably going to have a whole lecture on this when David Buss talks. Yeah,
I was going to say that. He has the answer.
Yeah, he has the answers. We do see broad patterns of some aspects of mating systems in humans and in non-humans. I mean, from my point of view, I think sometimes we get too hung up as to asking to what degree is genetics versus culture playing a role here. And I think when you get nice parallels, you certainly don't want to assume that this is due to genetic variation. In fact, I mean, Lisa made a very good point of this. When this study came out, this big GWAS study of quote-unquote gay genes, and I'm saying this as a biologist, I thought it was interesting that so many behavioral geneticists were patting themselves on the back. Look, we explained 30% of the variants. And very few, not just in the scientific article, but in very few follow-ups, did anybody ever say, wonder what's going on with those other two-thirds of the variation. So it's like the holy grail is to show that there's some heritability. And just my view is that there's some heritability in most things. And sometimes it's a little, and sometimes it's a lot. And that also, as Lisa pointed out, you have this really strong interaction between genes and environment. As you pointed out, you didn't talk about epigenetics, but we know it's not just what genes you have, but what genes are being expressed in certain situations. So I'm pretty careful myself about making those analogies. But like I said, you know, David Buss has just done phenomenal work in this field that you'll get to see pretty soon.